Good morning. I hope everybody enjoyed your coffee. I was really happy that Dries spoke about all the new and amazing features that go into Drupal 8, and he even called them our tools. But as our tools improve and we ready, like we all work to ready the next level of amazing and powerful tools, it becomes even more important to look at what do we build with those tools and how do we do it, and why do we do it. So that's, I'm really happy to have the pleasure to introduce Eric Rice. I've stolen a quote from the internet from one of our competitors. The CEO of Sitecore said, "Eric Rice is a one-man army. He's simply the most talented creative marketing professional that I have ever worked with." So I thought, we need to get him here. If our competitors are using this weapon, we need to get it. Eric is a content strategist. He's the CEO of Fat Ducks Copenhagen, Fat Ducks Group. He's a published author on information architecture, usability, human-computer interaction. He's also very busy, but luckily for us, Eric is supportive of the Drupal project and community, and he worked really hard to be here today. So I'm happy to introduce you. Without further ado, thank you, Eric.
Yes, but tusind tak skal du have. Thank you. And thank you all for coming. I realize, you know, foregoing coffee is like, that's kind of a big thing at conferences this morning. Just so I can figure out how to do this talk, let me ask you a few questions. How many of you are developers? Okay. And how many of you consider yourself designers? Okay, about half and half. How many of you have a hangover? All right. When you call yourself developers, and we're in the front-end track, what front-end are you referring to? Are you referring to the front-end that Drupal gives to its users or to the websites that are being produced using Drupal, the people who are creating those, and the final result? Did you understand the question? Okay, you know, you can design two kinds of front ends. The front end that people like me see, because I'm a user of the web, or the front end that, it, for example, in Drupal 8, with you know the various best practices that have been built into it, the WYSIWYG editor and so on. So when you develop front end, are you developing WYSIWYG editors for Drupal and similar things, or are you designing websites? Are you building websites? Excuse me? Building websites, okay. good. How many of you are over 50? Is anyone here over 50? Oh, all right, a couple of us, and we admit to it. Then you remember when we were doing development back in the 1970s, we had a card deck, and we had all these punch cards, and we'd, at least in my university, we'd give them to somebody who sat behind a little window, and then the next day we could find out that the program crashed on card 27, and you'd have to try and figure out, okay, what went wrong. We talk about PowerPoint decks in the same way we talked about program decks in the old day. Well, I decided that for today, I'm actually going to have a deck. So all of you over in the cheap seats, nothing's going to happen on that screen. I don't want to disturb them. They're busy, apparently. So I had some questions. Those were them. There are three reasons I shouldn't be here. The first is I don't actually have a degree in HCI or anything else that's moderately relevant. I haven't coded anything in 25 years. And perhaps the worst admission of all is I've never built anything in Drupal. So, of course, you say, well, so why the hell is he here? Well, for one, I wrote one of the very first commercial programs for the Apple II back in 1979, I guess it was. I wrote a CMS back in 1984 so that I could do the first Danish language adventure game. But more important, oh, I was also chairman of Sitecore for a while. We won't talk about that. But more importantly, I am a user. I'm the guy who goes in and tries to break things and tries to optimize the user experience for our clients. And this is kind of what I'd like to talk to you about today. There are three purposes for this talk. First, I want you to think differently about your work and what you're doing. I want, of course, to build the Drupal community. And finally, I want wanted to help increase the joy of using the Drupal product. And certainly a lot of very good things are happening with Drupal number 8. I also have three steps that I want to describe to you that I think will help you look at your jobs a little differently than you did when you came in this morning. At least I hope so. I'm going to tell you a lot of stories, and some of them you'll say, well, this is irrelevant to me. Others, maybe not so irrelevant. Drupal, the droplet originally, was a PHP program, and PHP stands for personal home page. Now, somewhere along the line, we got into hypertext preprocessor, and I'm honestly not quite sure what the hell a hypertext preprocessor is. You know, if you have a cake mixer, is that a cake preprocessor? I mean, I don't know. Maybe the chicken is an ingredient preprocessor because it lays eggs. I think that there's some strange terms that get used, and they're pretty geeky terms at that, and that's something that has a tendency to turn off people who are genuinely interested in using your product but can't quite figure out the terminology that's being used. They can't quite figure out the code. Drupal 8, of course, is going to do marvelous things to move things in a new direction, but Drupal 8 ain't out there yet. It's important that we do try and make things easy for the people who are using our product, and also the people who are using the website. And Idris kind of scared the shit out of me when he started, because he said, well, you know, we want to ask why. And that is exactly the critical question. And we're going to talk a lot about the whys of various things this morning. But he says, helping individuals build their dream. And I think that that's more a what than a why. They're building. Do we want to help them build, or do we want to help them achieve their dream? There's a huge difference there. So I ask you again, so why do you do what you do? Why are you in this business? Is it to earn money? Is it because you're going to save the world? Why do you do what you do? Why is Drupal a better choice than Ektron or Episerver or Sitecore or the other open source things that are out there? Typo3, Umbraco. Why are you here? You can talk.
Why not?
Why not? Okay.
Because it's versatile enough.
Excuse me?
It's versatile enough.
Okay.
Because for me, you asked.
Yes.
You asked if we were building websites or with
right.
Interfaces. I'm building neither of them. Actually, I'm building two.
Yes.
For my customers, so they can use them. Because they're two for reporting, mm-hmm. two is for inserting data.
Right.
It's an interface, it's just a tool. It has to be useful and simple. So it's not a website.
No, all right, well, that fair enough. I mean, I understand how one builds CMSs.
It's versatile because it has to be for HR, human resources, and finance. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I hear a lot of what and very little why in that. You're building a tool and you describe the tool. Let me tell. Excuse me.
I picked Drupal over, let's say, SharePoint and the higher salaries because of the community. I mean, it was fun to learn. It was fun to interact, and I enjoyed that the tool allowed me to be disruptive, to do disruptive stuff. And be part of something that was up and coming. That was the why. I mean, I enjoyed changing things instead of just building on the status quo.
There's nothing wrong with any of these answers. I'm just trying to push you a lot further. Yes, sir. That's a very good why answer. Let me tell you some why stories. First of all, years ago, there was a company in Denmark called Time Manager International, and they made SAS Airline of the Year in 19, 85, and British Airways, that had been privatized, approached Time Manager and asked if they couldn't do the same thing. And they were doing service design programs. And I had the dubious honor of standing in Heathrow Airport for 3 days and interviewing passengers. What were they expecting in terms of service from an airline and so on? And there were a lot of surprises along the way. By the way, how many of you are Danish? Because I've heard more Danish here than English or German or anything, or Czech for that matter. So British Airways had a couple of ideas. They thought the why of their business was to get people from A to B. It was a transport service. And they approached their business as though it was a transport service. And it wasn't even a very good one at that. They decided flying on time was going to be a great service parameter. But the truth is, the passengers got really mad if you said, well, flying on time, isn't that a good thing? They said, no, you're supposed to fly on time. This is why we have schedules. We're taking your airplane because we're going to a meeting. We have people meeting us at the airport. We have other flights to catch. You're supposed to fly on time. And it turned out the service parameters for British Airways were very, very different than what any of us had anticipated. And one of the reasons for this was, quite simply, that we didn't use British Airways to get from A to B. We used British Airways because we wanted to go to a meeting, because we were going to go on holiday. It was part of a continuum that included taxis at one end and a bus at the other. And when British Airways suddenly realized that they were part of something much, much larger, they could also change the way in which they approached their market, change their marketing message, and people started to like the airline. And in fact, they became the European Airline of the Year in 1986. So we were quite proud of that. So it's really easy to make assumptions, and I'm going to get back to making assumptions based on faulty data in a little while. Another story, though, is how many of you remember the Creative Zen? It was an MP3 player. Creative had really good technology. They had really tweaked the MP3 algorithm, and it was good stuff. And it was at a good price point. And it was marketed as a 5 gigabyte MP3 player. That's what it is. But that's not why. That's not anything that inspires confidence in the product or love for the product or builds market share. It's just saying, this is a great chair. Instead of saying, this is a whatever. The iPod was launched about a year later. The technology wasn't as good. The interface was a little questionable, at least in the first go round. But they got to the why. Thousands of songs in your pocket. That is a radically different message than a 5 gigabyte MP3 player. And where is the Creative Zen today, and where is the iPod today? If you can figure out the why of Drupal and communicate that, both within your organizations, but also to your customers and to your teams, you're going to come a lot further. And I think that this is one of the areas that Drupal really needs to work on. I spent a lot of time reading about Drupal, and I'll tell you, it's a little hard to find the why. It's a little hard to find the why. And when I can't find the why, I, as somebody who recommends CMS systems to clients, have a little trouble figuring out why I should choose your product, our product, over someone else's. There's a third story that I'd like to... I think I'll skip that for now. Anyway, let's think about the why, because basically these are the three steps. If you can figure out the why, and if you understand the why of what you're doing, and I like the idea of solving problems, that's a good starting point for working out a more sophisticated why. The why will then explain the what. And when you know the what, then you can go out and you can do the how. It's kind of the basics of change management. The CEOs, they know what, I'm sorry, they're supposed to come with the vision, the why, to lead us forward, so that the middle managers can figure out the what and the frontline personnel can do the how. Same thing. If you can figure out the why, and I can't find it on the internet, and unfortunately I didn't hear enough of it this morning, but clearly the thought is there, but it hasn't been crystallized yet. It hasn't been formulated. I don't think that we're helping people build their dream. I think we're trying to help them achieve their dream. And this is not a semantic nitpicking. I think it is a basic fundamental difference in the way you look at the product. You're about to move from something that was very, very geeky to something that is very, very user-friendly. It's certainly, I mean, a far cry from Drupal 6. So people are also going to also be making different demands of you than they have in the past. There are a lot of things that are going to change. My next question is, how many of you actually go out in the field and watch people use Drupal? Some of you. Remarkably few. Do you know how people actually use what you build? Yes? Never in the way you expect. Thank you. That was exactly what I wanted to hear. Now, as a speaker at DrupalCon, see, we get these decks given to us and said, this is the format, this is what we want you to do. Now, let me ask you, why do we have a cover slide for a speaker at a conference? Why do we have it? To show that you're in the right room, okay. What else?
That you're at the right conference.
What, you were in doubt? You thought this was Web Expo? Just in case. Oh, Lewis. Okay, what other things do you want to get out of that slide? Yes?
Quickly capturing the essence of what you're trying to communicate.
Okay, capturing the essence of what you want to communicate. What other basic information, if we're going to look at this in terms of content strategy, what do we want to be putting on that slide?
Surprises.
Excuse me?
Surprises.
Surprises?
Yeah, sometimes surprises.
Okay. Because I was thinking of, you know, in more mundane terms, like the Twitter handle for the person who's speaking, the name of the person who's speaking. It might also help if you did this in a typeface that could actually be read. Let me tell you, I cheated because I do have a little clicker here and I do have a couple of slides. This is the basic template. So half of the page, the one at the top, the one that's easy to see if you've got somebody tall sitting in front of you, is telling you that you were at DrupalCon in Prague. Click to add title and click to add subtitle. There is nothing about Twitter. There is nothing about the name of the presenter. The typefaces are so big in this that you can't have a title that's much more than about 11 characters. This is not a good template, but on the other hand, this is kind of the way Drupal thinking has been for an awful long time. We are not thinking about the why we have these things. And I'm not trying to be nasty here. I'm just trying to point out that you're on the cusp of a major change. There's something very, very exciting in your community. All the stuff that Dries talked about this morning just blew me away. The accessibility issues, there are all kinds of things that are marvelous. The WYSIWYG editor, I mean, as a content provider, this is something that I can't wait to see. And I'll tell you, you know, we use Sitecore in my company. I don't think Sitecore necessarily follows best practices, but it is what it is. So we have our DrupalCon thing. And somebody needed to back up and say, why do we do this before they start designing logos? Screw the logo. You're not here because of their logo. You're here because there's a conference to attend. You want to capture the essence of what the talk is going to be about, and so on and so forth. How many of you know a designer by the name of Charles Eames? Charles and Ray Eames, they did this chair, which is kind of iconic. This was designed for the Hollywood film director, Billy Wilder, who did Some Like It Hot and other classics. Charles Eames, and this goes exactly to your point, say it again. They never use it the way you expect it. This is Charles Eames at a hotel in London. He works standing up. So he stacks the hotel furniture so that he can work. Now, I don't think the hotel had this in mind when they designed it. How many of you are staying at the Corinthia across the way? Okay. How many of you have been fighting trying to figure out where the light sockets or the plugs were so that you could charge things? How many of you had to unplug the coffee machine so that you could charge your phone? Well, you know, the Corinthia, if you know the history, it's a 30-year-old hotel. It was sort of the socialist, it was a prestige project for Czechoslovakia, and it was built about the same time as the conference center here. So you're not supposed to have things that you plug in, and even though it's been remodeled, nobody has put in extra plugs. There's nowhere to plug in a computer. There's nowhere to plug in a phone. They have hair dryers, but there's no place to plug in a hair dryer. And if you do, you can't. If the cord is too short, so you can't actually see the mirror if you've crawled underneath the desk and unplugged something else. So, you know, it hasn't really been thought through. The Corinthia is marketing itself as a very modern hotel, but they haven't really gotten to where they need to be. They're still living with some things from the past. And there are going to be things from Drupal 7 that are going to live for a while, but it's your job, when you've defined the why, to start spotting out what needs to be done. It's not just a question of patches. You know, if you don't know why you do what you do, I urge you, spend some time, think about this, because when you've got the why, you'll know what the what is, and you'll know how to do it. I think that too many people, not just in this community, but in many developer communities, spend so much time thinking about the what that sometimes they forget a little bit why they're there. Why they're trying to make the world a better place if they're doing that at all. I have some thoughts about Drupal in general. I think it's really good that Drupal has finally accepted best-of-breed products and is starting to integrate. This is one of the problems we have with our CMS. We had the same problem with Type of 3. We have the same problem with Sitecore. They both had proprietary blogging tools, and nobody ever blogs at FatDucks because nobody can remember from one time to the next how you're supposed to do it. So one of the other things that you can think about before you get too terribly creative in trying to be different or whatever is that there is a logical function called retroductive inference. And that means you learn something one place and you're able to use those skills somewhere else. So this is why we have logos that people recognize, even though the logos themselves, or I'm sorry, icons, don't seem to make sense to anybody. I mean, just think of all the people who gladly click on a little diskette to save their work. And you sort of wonder how many of these people have even seen a diskette. But we accept it as that's our icon of choice. And that's fine. Because you've seen it in Microsoft, you've seen it on your Apple, you've seen it all kinds of places. I mean, we've got a Western Electric telephone receiver designed in the 1930s by Henry Dreyfuss. I mean, when's the last time anybody had a telephone like this? Not recently, but that's the icon we accept. So the best of breed things generally do build on retroductive inference. They build on things that people know. They can take skills that they've learned somewhere and use them somewhere else. And the screenshots that I saw this morning were really very, very good because, you know, I could hit the ground running with these tools. I knew how to work them. I can't do that in Drupal 7. The core is good, and you need to work on that. My clients tell me, though, I don't really get Drupal because there's this thing at the bottom, and then I've got all these Lego blocks, and I really don't know how I'm supposed to assemble a site. I think that's a misconception, but it's something that you're going to have to work on so that people do understand that it's maybe not as intimidating as they think it is. When you read that there are almost 30,000 different developer modules, that's kind of scary. That can turn off a lot of people who are marketing directors and others who are ultimately buying your services because they don't really understand the tool. They'd rather buy something proprietary because then, you know, if anything goes wrong, they know who to blame. It's not a very good attitude, but that's the kind of thing that we hear. There is a trade-off. Open source generally means more development time. It shouldn't, but it often does. And a lack of accountability. Whereas if you buy a Sitecore or an Ektron or an Episerver, then you know who to talk to. But the problem is they have exorbitant license fees, and there's also a lot of coding in that too. So you have a tremendous opportunity with Drupal 8 to go in and really start changing things and making things interesting and accessible to ordinary people. I'm not talking about people who are sight impaired or anything like that, but accessible to just average people, like that guy who was one of your personas this morning, who said, you know, I had to give up. I couldn't do it. That's a shame. And this is why things like WordPress are doing so well, because they go in and they say, hey, you know, it's dead easy, and you buy a theme for $20, and you know, how much functionality do you actually need? Another little disappointment from this morning was that all of the websites shown all around the world looked like cookie cutter models of each other. And you can buy this shit on Dotster for $60 a pop with code and picture rights. There are a row of tabs at the top, a big useless picture, and three things you can click on underneath. That's the design right now. We've got to move beyond that. User experience is not a big useless picture. But that's what we're designing. And with the exception of the penguins in Antarctica, every one of the sites looked like that. There was one that actually had a form out on the right, but for the most part, it's just same, 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 same. And I know some of these sites, and they're not particularly function-rich. You could probably have done it in WordPress. You've got to move beyond that. You've got to show the world why yours is a much more interesting product. If we look at the future of our industry, I think it's important to think, you know, are we a CMS or are we a digital platform? And I think that we are a digital platform. We are not just a publishing tool to the internet, but we need to publish to multiple channels and in different ways. And this isn't just a question of being responsive or adaptive. This is a question of actually doing something that is responsive to the needs of the user and not just the needs of the device. If I need to figure out how the Prague metro system works, I can go on the internet and I can find their map and I can chart out a route. But if I'm standing in the middle of Prague, I want to point my smartphone and I want it to tell me that the nearest station is there and it's 200 meters away. That's a very different kind of experience. And this is what we need to be doing. We are not thinking enough about it. It's not just mobile first. And mobile first, by the way, is a very dangerous term because cheapskate clients in a down economy have a tendency to say, well, it's mobile only. And so they'll do something that'll work on a smartphone but doesn't actually work on a laptop or a large screen. I mentioned before about making assumptions. Let me tell you a story. Let me see how my time is doing. Oh, we're in good shape. I want to tell you a story. How many, are there any Americans in the audience? Okay, one, two, three, four. Oh, you're not sure? Okay, no, I'm just asking. All right, I'm going to tell you a story. Now, listen closely. It's a cold January day, and the charismatic 43-year-old chief executive of his country has just been sworn in. Okay? His predecessor is standing next to him, a general who 15 years earlier had led his country's army in a war that ultimately led to the defeat of Germany. After the swearing in, the young chief executive, 43 years old, stood and watched parades in his honor for 5 hours and then partied until 3 in the morning. Are we all on the same page here? Do you know who I'm talking about? Who am I talking about? Excuse me? Eisenhower wasn't 43, but he was a general. What? Kennedy. How many of you thought it was Kennedy? Okay. It isn't. It's actually Adolf Hitler. There are a lot of similarities between, they were both 43 years old, Kennedy and Hitler. They both were preceded by generals. I sucker punched you to some extent by asking how many Americans there were, just to try and prime the pump and get you to think in terms of something other than, I was very careful in introducing my general. I said, no, he was a general that led his country's army in a war that ultimately led to the defeat of Germany. I didn't say that he was on the winning side. This is a problem when we go out and we do our research. Yes, sir.
There was no coffee. I just
want
to point out
the line of the coffee was very long. So we're slow. Oh, well, that's all right. We're that's okay. That's good. You're going to hear about big data throughout this conference because that's what people are into now. I mean, when the Harvard Business Review puts something on the cover, you know that everybody's going to talk about it for a long time. You also know that the subject's been around for about 2 years before Harvard Business Review starts to write about it. That's a different matter entirely. But big data, if we take a look at, there's an international chain of stores called Walmart. And they have a turnover that's larger than the gross national product of many, many countries. They collect enough data, I can't remember how many petabytes they do, but every hour, if they printed this data out, it would fill 20,000 filing cabinets. Every hour. That's big data. It's not a question of collecting the data, but it's a question of trying to see the patterns. And what happens is here, I gave you a lot of data and said, can you spot a historic something in it? But in fact, there's a pattern that repeated from January 1933. You've got to be very careful when you start analyzing the data to make sure that you're asking all of the right questions, that you've done something that actually really differentiates what you're working on from what your assumptions may lead you to. In this case, the question that was missing was, what date was this? Again, this is all going back to the why, because if we don't understand why we're doing things, we're going to end up building the wrong thing. A little more about the future. I have an acronym I call ESP, like extrasensory perception. I think that this is where a lot of things are going to be going in the future. And the first is that we are going to be able to extract patterns. Our phones are going to be able to extract patterns from what we're doing. Certainly Google is already doing this. Walmart, with all their data, discovered that in Florida, when there's a hurricane, they sell out of a small pastry that you put in the toaster called a Pop-Tart, strawberry Pop-Tarts. And so they went in and they analyzed the data and they said, okay, when there's a hurricane, everybody buys these crappy little pastries and strawberry. Why not blueberry or any one of the other flavors? That was the pattern, and using the pattern, then they went out and they started to interview people. Well, in Florida, when you have a hurricane, the power goes out. So you end up eating cold spaghetti out of a can or something else. You have no electricity, no air conditioning, you have no phone service. So you have a lot of canned goods, and that's what you need to eat for the week or two until services is restored. It turns out that strawberry Pop-Tarts are one of the few flavors that you can eat without gagging because it's so dry when the power is out, when you can't heat it up. Who knew? Walmart knows. Hurricane on its way to the south. Stock up on strawberry Pop-Tarts. So we've got to start looking at, you know, what kinds of things can we spot. It's not just a question of patches and this, but to figure out the why. Where are we going? What are we doing? So extract patterns. That's what our tools, our platform needs to be able to do. And then it also has to become situationally aware. And I'm thinking, of course, location. That's pretty easy. All the phones have GPS. But also motion-based. We have magnetometers and we have accelerometers already in our phones. you know, does it know whether I'm standing still or whether I'm moving? These are the kinds of tools that are going to have to be built into Drupal so that people can use this kind of information, so that if I am in Prague at 9 in the morning, maybe I'm looking for a bank, and if I'm in Prague at 9 in the evening, maybe I'm looking for a bar. Let it start to make at least some basic predictions. Somebody mentioned personalization this morning. I go, well, I guess it was Dries. And I think we're going to see a lot more personalization because there just is so much information out there. If we are going to use augmented reality or Google Glass, I mean, there's a lot of stuff that is changing our world right now. We're going to have to start building tools that make all of this possible for us. So I guess basically that's my message to you. It's not very deep, but I think ultimately it's going to move you forward. You've got to think about the why. You know, unhappy customers can result in really, really, really bad things. And happy customers are won over by good design. So that's really what I had to say. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. We have about 15 minutes for questions. Anything? You all want coffee, is what you want. Yes?
When you had mentioned earlier about WYSIWYG and core, things like that, I can yell, that's fine. WYSIWYG and core, things like that, and people saying, and clients saying Drupal is hard to use, isn't it, or the perception of Drupal being hard to use, isn't it up to us as the ones who are building the sites and giving those sites to clients to ensure the site they are getting is easy to use for them? I don't expect my clients to learn Drupal and to understand that they have to alter this view to change something on a page. If they want the ability to change something, I make sure that they have an easy way of doing it. So isn't it somewhat unfair to wrap Drupal into this hard-to-use stereotype when it's really up to the individuals? Because if a client says the website is hard to use, no matter what system you built it is, you probably failed.
We're talking about two different things. Whether website usability is good or bad, that's up to the designers. Either you know how to do interaction design or you don't. And there are various best practices, and there are design patterns, and all kinds of other things. There are a lot of resources, and we've got a lot of research and case studies now that show how good web design is affected. However, when somebody wants to upload new content, they're not going to call you. They're going to do that themselves. That's where Drupal comes in. And if you cannot figure out how to upload content or add a picture or change your metadata, then there's a problem. And this is exactly the problem that many users of Drupal face. It came from a very, very geeky background, and you've made quantum leaps, but you're not there yet. If you look at Typo3 just sort of petered out. And it's completely geeky, and even two different implementations of the same site on Typo3 will look different in the back end. So there are some people who got rich, you know, reskinning this so that they could hide all the geekiness. That's not the way to design. That's just a patch.
Once again, isn't it up to the people building the sites to make sure that adding a photo is easy? Because my clients can really easily add photos onto their site, and they won't pick the wrong size. They won't put it somewhere where it's going to break the layout or anything like that.
Well, I beg to differ. I hear from people that, no, we can't use Drupal to do that. Now, maybe their implementation of Drupal is crap.
I guess that's my point. It's not a Drupal problem.
Yes, it is, because if people have the perception that this is a difficult product to use, then they're not going to use it. Our job now is to make sure that people understand that the perception is wrong. I drive a Jaguar. Everybody laughs, oh, you have to have two Jaguars. You have to one in the shop and one on the road. This was because they built really shitty cars in the middle of the 70s. Yeah, the last 10, 15 years, they've made very good cars, but there's still a stigma attached to that particular mark. And Drupal has a stigma of being a very technically sophisticated product that's difficult for ordinary people to approach. And yes, you can do a very good implementation, but there are a lot of people who aren't doing good implementations. And hopefully, with aid, then a lot of the crap that I see out there is not going to be happening. And it's not a question of the end user design, it's a question of the back end for the publishers, for the content providers, for the publishing rights. I mean, we did not choose Drupal for our site, not because I'm married to Sitecore in any way, but your language layer sucked. Our site is in 9 languages, and we couldn't administrate it properly in Drupal. We couldn't do the things we wanted to do. Now, that is one of the issues that's being addressed in 8, and I think that that's going to make a major change for you also. There are a lot of good things on the way. There are a lot of good things in the current version. Lisa Reichelton, all the people who worked so hard on making Drupal 7 a reality, really worked hard. I mean, it's a quantum leap from 6 to 7. But there's a perception, and it doesn't mean that perception and reality are the same thing, but it's something that we need to fight against. Okay, you had a question.
No, basically just thinking that I haven't met a CMS that is ungeeky or easy to use, except from WordPress, which is, yeah, they have a way to say, yeah, this is easy, but then you have the problem that when you want to extend it, then it's getting very geeky. So, yeah, it's really what you buy into, and I think the extendability of Drupal is really nice. But yes, I can see that for a normal user, very often you have them in the phone saying, how come I can't upload a photo or something? But I think things change as well. So it might be that in the 50s, Jaguar made lousy cars, but it also might be that Drupal made lousy CMS in the version 6. But I think that 7 is actually a lot better than 6, and I hope it keep improving, because everybody's talking about how WordPress can do.
No, I agree with you entirely. I think that Sitecore is geeky. I think Episerver is geeky. I think Ektron is geeky. My goodness, some of the best known CMSs, the really hardcore ones, say 15 years ago, were Vignette Story Server and Interwoven. I mean, you didn't even get code. You got a stack of books that told you how to put together a website. It was crazy, and it was violently expensive. And you could have 20 developers sitting in a meeting room for half a year coding this site. It was crazy, and today things are much, much easier. But I think that this is also an opportunity for Drupal, that because everything is still a little not so understandable to old-time journalists and others who are assuming content provider roles, I think you have an opportunity really to do something and to change that perception. But there's hard work in front of you. Yes, sir. Well, you've got Joe, and so that's certainly a Last night, I spent about 10 minutes trying to find out where my own session was and when it was going to start. The information architecture was appalling. So, friends, you know, all of these kinds of things send out signals. Take the survey link. I mean, this is a PowerPoint. How do you click on that link? These things need to be thought through. And I don't think that they always are. And you do have a remarkable opportunity now, and I beg you all to go out there and to really change the world. You can do it.
I'm feeling quite uncomfortable because I'm here and so lucky to work in a web team where there are two UX experts, so they help us with that. I think that's one direction we should take to embark UX as one of the main guidance, not only for Drupal. It's not only a problem for Drupal, it's for widespread technology. I think we could be, if we had to make a comparison between web things and, for instance, cars, is that, yeah, we have a sort of a taste of standards, but in the car manufacturing and standards, you expect to find the gear in a certain position, brakes in a certain position.
Right. Well, that was best practices. It's interesting you mentioned cars, because up until 1916, that is to say 20 years after the first commercial automobile in 1896, that was the first time the standard H pattern was introduced as a shift in the 1916 Cadillac. And by 1920, there was a lot of standardization for the simple reason that people were now in the car rental business. And you didn't have time to teach people to drive every time you rented out a new car. It took Henry Ford a long time to, if you've ever driven a Model T, this is a completely screwball car. And has absolutely no relation to the way we would think of cars being driven today. You shift gears by holding down a pedal and then releasing a pedal, and the gas is actually a lever on the steering column. It's not an easy car to drive. But standardization is coming, and we're seeing that in the way that WYSIWYG editors, for example, look. The order of the icons is first it's bold, then it's italic, then it's underlined. We have a lot of standards that we're working on, and that's good. So retroductive inference. We can use things we learn one place and use them someplace else. But you're also right about user experience being part of it, because if the WYSIWYG editor works fine, but then you can't figure out how to save your work or something else goes wrong, user experience ultimately is the sum total up in your head following a series of interactions between people, processes, and machines. It can be between two people, it can be between two machines. If two servers are fighting it out in the background and I'm waiting for a download, my experience is bad. So it's also up to us when we look at our modules to choreograph this experience across multiple touch points also within the program.
Just, I think when having a discussion like this, it's easy to get defensive. But I mean, the fact that Type 03 sucks worse, and we might be on par with Sitecore, it doesn't liberate us from our both the need and the the need to move on and improve. I mean, it's also our opportunity, because if everybody else is standing still and we continually try to take a critical look at ourselves and improve our user experience, we will get ahead. So, I mean, yeah, Sitecore might be just as bad, and everybody knows Type 03 sucks, but we should still keep improving the user experience and keep asking ourselves why.
I hope I didn't insult you in any way, because I don't mean to. But I can come here and I can jabber for an hour about all the wonderful things about Drupal, but you already know that. That's why you're part of the community. I come in as somebody who deals with clients and marketing directors and others, and these are the things that I hear and these are the things that I've experienced. There was a hand here. Yes, sir.
I think that there is a difference between how different groups view Drupal. So some people feel we need to market Drupal. We don't necessarily think that's the right way to go about it now. Drupal is not a product. Drupal is a tool that lets you build a CMS. And I think what was being hinted at before is, you know, you spend as much time building and designing the back. of setting up yourself to fail right now. Because it's only going to work when it's a good product, and it's not a good product out of the box as you download it on Drupal.org. It's a good tool. It's a different thing.
Well, you said something very interesting, and this is not anything that I've ever heard before. I understand what you mean, but I have never heard this expressed by anyone, that Drupal is a tool to build a CMS. It's true, but this isn't the public perception.
Oh yeah, no, I agree.
All right. Well, so if people think that they're going to get a CMS, and they're going to be that interaction with the product is going to start out in a very negative way. And so these are the things that I think that we need to get beyond. Perhaps there need to be sort of standard Drupal packages. And so here is the CMS. Here is the e-commerce tool. Here's the customer experience management kit to go on top of your CMS. Here is the stuff that we can add on to introduce social media into the publishing flow of what we're doing. So there are lots of opportunities. And I mean none of this in a bad way towards the Drupal community. It's just that it's a waste of time if I just come up here like a cheerleader and rah, rah, rah. I talk to people who don't necessarily like the product, and I'm trying to share this with you. Sir?
The thing is, I think there's actually an interesting point there, because it sort of backs up the point that the community is too geeky. This exists. It's called installation profiles. But, I mean, who the hell is going to understand that other than somebody who does Drupal anyway? Because we have installed profiles, but it doesn't really mean a lot to people. And how do people know where to find it? They don't know that either. So it's not being marketed. So, I mean, it's great to see Drupal 8 is moving along and all this stuff, but I'm not really sure that that's where we need the main initiative. I think it's better to say Drupal 7 can be good enough for what you want to do, but it needs a lot of work specifically for you.
Good point.
This is a really good discussion, and actually there's an issue for Drupal.org to make a landing page that shows off the different Drupal distributions. And I think what Jenny's saying before was right, that ultimately it's up to the site builders to create a good user experience for their clients, because they know the little, you know, the use cases and the little niches and stuff like that. But I do a lot of work on Drupal core usability, and I think the benefit there is providing really good tools to allow the site builders and the distribution developers to actually make that into a really good tool. So yeah, it's not a question, sorry, but there's a lot of work we're doing in Drupal 8.
Just to notice first about type of 3, okay, it sucks. I tried it. But in Switzerland, all the administration is using type of 3. I mean, all the council is 26, all the cities, everyone. So it sucks, but everybody is using it.
And so does Lufthansa and Volkswagen. I mean, it's the largest CMS system in Germany.
Something, you have a page, 2 days later, you will get all the information and you have your report. That's all. I don't advertise it. So for me, advertising, yes, maybe to your customers, to mine, as me as customer. But I won't tell them to my directors, my departments, that it's Drupal. Or maybe they will ask me afterwards, yes, it's Drupal. But not in front. It's completely different.
It's a good point. People ask me, so what would you recommend in terms of a CMS? And there, Drupal is on the list. And so, well, if you want open source, this is the one that I would choose. I wouldn't go with Joomla or some of the other things out there. But
in my case, I'm not saying that they want to build an intranet, or they want to build something that is useful. I'm not saying that, okay, we will build a CMS, or even they tell me, no, you need something that will give you what you want. Now, if it's Drupal, okay, I can help you because I'm developing.
as long as you can keep the technical parts away from the people like me who no longer code and just want to be able to go and use it pretty much as, you know, an easy way to get content online or to correct a layout or whatever. I mean, there's a continuum of what we know. We know nothing. We know a lot. We know something. And on this line, this is what we know and this is what we need to know in order to use the product. And our job, in terms of creating intuitive interfaces, is to make sure that these things are as close as possible to each other. It's really not more complicated than that. That applies to everything that we do. People go to one website and they expect to be able to use the skills that they've learned one place and apply them someplace else. How many of you had been to the Prague airport before a couple of days ago? Not so many of you. So this was your first time at the Prague airport. Wow, cool. Did you have trouble finding your baggage? No. It's because airports are incredibly standardized, as opposed to train stations across Europe. I'll tell you what, let's just save the problem. The point is that there are wayfinding conventions that are being used at airports, and although Prague may have certain problems, all airports have certain problems. My point, though, is that baggage is called baggage claim everywhere in the world. You can't even agree on what tracks are called and across Europe at train stations. Now, if some consultant comes in and says, we're going to be very innovative. And I go up and I hand somebody my passport, and the woman behind the counter says, yes, and you'll find your plane at port Q. I said, what? Port Q? I said, well, we had an innovation consultant, and you may know it as a gate, but we call it ports. And Q is the 17th letter of the Latin alphabet. So you may know it as gate 17, but we call it port Q. Have a nice flight. This would drive us crazy. This is what happens in a lot of... Typo 3 couldn't even label metadata correctly. I mean, there are three categories of HTML metadata. There's a meta title, keywords, description. They invented their own terms. People who actually knew how to code couldn't go into Typo 3 and figure out how to use it. This is crazy. These have been around for 20 years. Tony Byrne has been doing this all his life. The reports are very expensive. They cost several thousand dollars. But all of these things are benchmarked. If you Google Tony Byrne, B-Y-R-N-E, you'll find a lot of information. But he has a site called CMS something or other. I can't remember the title of it. But there's a lot of benchmarking material out there. Okay. Right, okay. Lunch, and I want to hear your story about the Prague airport.
We'll do that privately.
Listen, friends, you didn't get your coffee. Let's at least make sure you get your lunch. Thank you so much for listening, and thank you for coming.